When we talk about urbanization, we must remember that cities are basically parasites. We live off the excess produce of surrounding areas, and this cannot last forever. So see the history of cities all over the world. I am a historian. And what happened to Babylon on the Tigris-Euphrates, Luxor on the Nile, all our Indus cities, Mohenjo-Daro, Dholavira, all gone with the wind. And why did this happen? I'd like to go back to the environment. This is because we basically do not remember the environment when we plan for cities, for urbanization. It is building, and since this is a company which is into real estate development building, I would like you to keep in mind the very important role that the environment plays. I always feel that if you want to speak of environmental health, just see whether the five bhutas, our ancestors gave it to us very simply, panchabhuta, apa, water, land, energy or agni, air and akasha. Let's leave out akasha or outer space. Let's talk about what we have been doing. Chennai as a city had 250 water bodies. Today they are less than 50. What happened to the remaining 200? They were either misused, filled with junk, sold, as Mr. Bhagat said, by corrupt politicians and corrupt bureaucrats to corrupt builders. Everybody here is corrupt. When you give, when you take, everyone is being corrupt. And as a result, we have a water problem. So, fortunately, we have a mandatory rainwater harvesting in every building, but that is not enough for a city like Chennai. Today, over 50% of the world's population is living in cities. And in Tamil Nadu, it's gone up to over 60%. So you can just imagine what is happening. People from rural areas are coming into cities as environmental refugees, not necessarily economic. Our literacy rate is over 80%. But we have about 820,000 slum dwellers, the fourth largest in India. Now, Indian cities have always had this duality. Delhi has the old Mughal and the British Raj. Bombay and Madras were rural villages, fishing villages, and even other villages like Mylapore, Triplicane. They were all part ancient villages. Madras has such an ancient history. In fact, I always argue with Mr. Muttaya when he talks about the British period, because we go back to Paleolithic times. We have Tamil Brahmi here. The Pallavas went from Mylapore to Southeast Asia. So we have such a wonderful history. And in spite of all that, in the last 200 years, we have been powered by industrial growth. And as a result of this, what has happened? We have really not planned, we have not grown. We've just grown haphazardly. In the early 50s, 60s, there was some attempt. There were some industrial estates like Guindy, Ambattur. Today, if you go, all of them have been sold out. And you have everything. I went to see a homeopathic doctor living in Ambattur industrial estate. So, you know, the industrial estate has ceased to exist. So these are some of the small problems we are talking about. I don't want to go into the woes of the city because you all know them. But what we have to remember is that the environment represents the most fundamental building blocks for development. If we do not take care of our environment, we are not going to be able to survive. Today you see the air pollution, you see the water pollution. Mr. Nirmal is growing plants inside his living room. If he didn't have those plants, he'd have a little more place to move around in. But he wants fresh air, he wants oxygen. So this is something we really have to see. So large communities of people are a problem because they live together in very tight spaces. But it's also a challenge and an opportunity for environmentally conscious development. Now, how is this possible? Cities can benefit the economy By locating human capital in one relatively small geographic area. I mean, cities are where you have great ideas, you have writers, you have artists, you have musicians, dancers, and that is what Chennai has produced. So living together, you have all these wonderful interchange of ideas. But when people and resources are located close to each other, it is possible to save energy and resources. That is what we are not doing now. We are bringing resources from elsewhere instead of building on our own capital, such as food, transportation. It's something we could have managed very easily, but we don't. Thus, urban conglomerations can be sustainable if we plan for their growth. We need sustainable cities, and I'm very happy that your invitation said sustainable cities. I hate the word sustainable development. There's no such thing as sustainable development, because development means change. And then once you have change, it cannot be sustainable. Either you live sustainably or you have a sustainable city, you can do things like that. But once you talk about development, it's not sustainable. So I'm very happy we are not using that term today. So what is this sustainable city that we all dream of? It is a city with a minimization of environmental impact, minimization of energy, water consumption, minimal output of heat. Climate change is a major problem today. There are many islands in the Sundarbans that have disappeared. We have a problem of air pollution, carbon dioxide, methane. And methane, do you know, India is producing the largest amount of methane in the world because of our growing farm animal population. And of course, Mr. Nirmal's area, management of waste. A sustainable city should therefore meet the needs of the present generation without sacrificing the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Now, this is a very ambiguous idea. And how can we go about it? Firstly, we have to see whether we cannot feed ourselves with minimal reliance on faraway places. That itself will cut our carbon footprint. Now, Mr. Nirmal spoke about growing his own tomatoes and onions. Today, we are getting apples from China, from Australia. Ladies and gentlemen, do not buy agriculture which comes from elsewhere. I make it a point never to buy apples except good old Simla, Himachal apples, even if they don't look very healthy. Try and cut down your carbon footprint. Then we need power with renewable energy sources. We have infinite solar energy. We have infinite wind power in a city like Chennai. Why do we have these 4-hour power cuts, 2 hours every day, and then 2 hours at various other times of the day? It should not have to be there at all, because we are not, I mean, the government is subsidizing all kinds of things. Instead of subsidizing fuel, petrol, they can subsidize photovoltaic cells so that we can all buy them at a reasonable cost and put them on our houses and have electricity. I'm not saying go back to living in the hut or in the cave. I know you want electricity, but we also have to see how we can cut down all this. Produce the lowest quantity of pollution possible. Now in Chennai, why can we not have public transportation running on CNG? But that itself is not good, because we are using up gas, which is not a renewable resource. We could have solar powered vehicles. They've come up in other parts of the world. And then, of course, we talk about waste, composting, so on, which is not being done. Now, Chennai should aim, and this is where planning for growth comes in. Firstly, we should source our agricultural produce. I really think this kind of buying agriculture from all over the world is a disaster for this country. We are talking about seed banks. We are soon going to find that we don't have enough food to feed our own people because we are so busy importing it. I saw it happen in China. It's happening. They're converting rice fields to cornfields to feed the pigs to sell the pork in Europe. This is such an unsustainable way of farming. And unfortunately, we, instead of learning the better things from China, we are learning things like this. Install more renewable energy sources. Instead of fighting over Kudankulam, whether it should or should not be, and instead asking for thermal energy, which is such a big polluter. I don't know how many of you have gone to North Madras. The people there have skins like crocodile. I mean, it's terrible. That's how badly polluted North Madras is. So why can we not have more renewable resources? We have to take a radically different approach to city planning with integrated business, industrial, and residential zones. Now, I'm sorry I'm going to talk about this hotel, but my cousin's son got married here 3 weeks ago. There were about 2,000 or 3,000 people at the reception. The whole of Mount Road was blocked. People came in cursing. I mean, I really felt bad about it. Now, this is a place where there should never have been a hotel. We all know what Mount Road is like. In this area where you're just going to the Tenampet crossing where the traffic is just unbearable. How can you have a hotel where you have big functions with lots of cars coming in? It's happening everywhere. I mean, I'm just giving you this hotel as an example. Take any hotel. There's no going back. There's no place for them to keep the cars and the roads get blocked. I live about 10 minutes from here. I could have walked down. But I'm scared because the traffic is horrendous. I came all the way around Gemini over here. Now that means India's petrol fuel bill goes up and I'm contributing to the raising of this. This is absolutely ridiculous. Then we come to buildings. All the new IT companies which are coming up have these very, very cold buildings, and all the girls there, I don't know how many of you have gone in there, they come to work in jackets, in sweaters, in Madras. I mean, you don't need a sweater even in winter, am I right, Mr. Nirmal? I don't think anyone wears a sweater, but they come because it's so cold. Why can we not use the open? Please come and see our schools. I have no windows. They're just complete grills, and the children get breeze right through the day. And they get light. You can plan your architecture so that you are not a burden on the environment. We have rainwater harvesting systems, but we do not have enough conservation systems. We have to go back to the lakes that made Madras. Why did people choose to live Madras? Live in Madras? Why did John Day choose to buy land over here? For the British to set up a factory because of the water, because of the tremendous water that was here. And yet today, if you wake up at 4 a.m. and 3 a.m., you'll find big queues of women with pots fighting over the water. It's tragic. I mean, a country which cannot give its water basic, I mean, give its people basic necessities like water. There's something very wrong with our development. We have to plan for things like this. So we need urban planning of a different nature. We need a conscious collective societal effort to imagine or reimagine an urban region and to translate the result into priorities and regulations for land use. We have no regulations. I have property on Eldams Road, TTK Road, I can put up a multi-storey building, I can put up a flat, I can have a factory in my garage, nobody can stop it. That is what it has become. So we have to have priorities and regulations for land use. We have to have conservation measures. Mr. Bhagat showed us Hong Kong, where he said 40%, am I right, is still open space and so on. I don't think we can say that. Thanks to Theosophical Society and Gindi, the Gindi Park and Adyar, we have some open space. And of course, our own foundation on Eldams Road. Otherwise, where are the open spaces? And if you go to North Madras, it's miserable. And we need new and improved settlements and infrastructure. At the core of urban planning is a concern with space. Planning is a strategic activity which highlights a developmental movement from the past to the future, not to the present. Today, when they plan to expand the roads, it's for the number of cars that are driving on the road today. By the time the road is finished 10 or 15 years hence, there will be twice the number of roads of cars, and the roads will no longer be enough. This is how our planning has been going. Planning projects a transition from one generation to another. My generation, Madras was an overgrown village. It was a lovely old world. Now the new generation is seeing a new Madras, especially in relation to infrastructure development, environmental management, and quality of life. Planning implies a mode of governance. That is what is missing in our planning. There is no governance and is shaped by values. Finally, I'd like to say, planning is concerned with making ethical judgments, ethical choices, and doing the right thing. Unless we do all take all this into consideration, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to just go from chaos to more chaos. We cannot survive it. I don't think you young people, so many young people here, deserve a city of chaos.